So hello everybody, myself Dr. Sneha Bhatia. So in my today's video, I will be talking about the special test for the lumbar instability. So test for lumbar instability. Lumbar instability implies that during the movement, the patient loses the ability to control the movement for a brief time. That can be in milliseconds, or it may mean the segment is structurally unstable. So basically, why we are doing the test for lumbar instability? In case if the patient is not able to control the movement, okay? So the structure may be unstable. So because of that, we are doing the special test. Now the brief loss of control often results in an instability jog or sudden shift of movement in part of the range of motion. And loss of control in the neutral spine. So instability can be also called as loss of control in the neutral spine. It is commonly seen with spondylosis owing to degeneration of the disc, and structural instability is primarily due to spondylolisthesis, and the following tests are designed to test the structural instability. So basically there are two tests. The one test is HNI stability test, and the second one is the specific torsion test. So for the HNI stability test, so this set of movement is designed to test for the muscle spasm and can be used to detect the instability. The HNI monikers relate to the movements that occur. So the movement is occurring in the fashion of H and I alphabetic letter. That is why it is called as HNI stability test. So in this, the picture 9.64 is given to denote this test. So here is the picture. This is the picture showing the HNI instability test. So before I tell you what is happening in the picture, let me describe the test. So here the first part of the test is the H movement, and the patient stands in the normal resting position, which would be considered the center of the H. So when the patient is standing in the normal position, that is considered as the center of the H alphabet. Now the pain-free side is tested first, and the patient is asked with guidance from the clinician to side flex as far as possible the side of the H. Okay, that is, while in this position, the patient is then asked to flex and then into extension. If the flexion was more painful than the extension would be done before the flexion. And the patient then returns to the neutral position and repeats the movement to the other side. So here what is happening? Let me tell you once again. First, the patient has to do the side flexion as far as possible. And then while in the side flexion position, ask the patient to flex. And then you ask the patient to extend. Now if flexion is more painful, then first ask the patient to do extension and then do the flexion in the side flex position. Okay. So now the patient then returns to the neutral and repeats the movement on the other side. Okay, so the clinician may stabilize the pelvis with one hand and guide the movement with the other hand on the shoulder. So here we can see the H portion. So first in this picture A, we can see the patient is performing side flexion. Okay, one hand of the therapist is on the shoulder, other hand is stabilizing the pelvis. You can see in the picture B, the patient is performing side flexion as well as forward flexion. In picture C, we can see the patient is performing side flexion and extension movement. Now, the second part of the test, that is the I movement, the patient stands in the normal resting position. This would be considered as the center of the I. Okay, so pain-free movement, whether it is flexion or extension, that is tested first. So same for how it was for the H part, it is the same for the I part. That is, when the patient is standing in the normal position, it will be considered as the center of the I. And whichever movement is pain-free, whether flexion is pain-free or extension is pain-free, that can be tested first. Now, with the guidance from the clinician, the patient is asked to forward flex or extend the spine of extend the lumbar spine until the hips start to move. That is the top part of the I. Once in flexion, the patient is guided into the side bending. Okay, so first you have to do the flexion, then you have to do the side bending. Okay, followed by return to neutral and then side bending to the opposite side. So the patient then returns to the neutral standing and does the opposite movement. Okay, followed by the side bending. So what we have seen in the edge part is that first the patient is performing the side flexion, then he is doing flexion or extension. In this case, the I part of the test, what we are seeing is the they are first performing either flexion or extension movement and then they are doing the side bending. So if there is a hypomobile segment present, at least two of the movement, okay, the movements into the same quadrant, for example, the top right of the edge and I would be limited. If instability is present, one quadrant will again be affected, but only by one of the moves, by the edge movement or about the eye movement, not the both. For example, if the patient has spondylolisthesis, instability in the anterior shear, then if the eye is attempted, the shear or slip will occur on the forward flexion and there will be little movement during the attempted side bending or flexion. So if the edge is attempted, the side bending will be normal and the following forward flexion will be full because the shear occurs in the second phase. So in this case, the eye movement would be limited but not the edge movement. So they are saying that in case of hypomobile joint, at least two of the movement, okay, that is the in the same quadrant, those movements will be affected. Or if the patient is having spondylolisthesis, that either edge part or the eye part can be affected. This test is primarily for structural instability, but an instability jog may be seen during one of the movement if loss of control occurs. In this case, the end range is commonly normal, but loss of control occurs somewhere in the available range of motion. So this that is about the edge and eye part of the test. So let us see the picture. So this is the picture. I have already told you picture A, that is the edge part. When the patient is in normal standing, that is the center of the edge. First patient is doing side flexion in the picture A. In picture B, patient is performing forward flexion. Picture C, patient is performing side flexion and extension. Now, so I told you about the picture C, that is the side flexion followed by the extension. In picture D, that is the eye test, this picture, okay, that is the forward flexion. In picture E, this picture, that is the part of the eye test, forward flexion and side flexion. So here you can see the patient has forward has done forward flexion and now going for side flexion. In this picture, picture F, that is the eye test, extension movement patient is performing. And in picture G, that is the again the eye test, in this extension and side flexion. So first you ask the patient to do the extension and then do the side flexion. Okay, so if the patient is not able to control the movement, patient is having pain, or he is feeling, he or she is feeling instability jaw, then the test will be considered as positive. The second test is the specific lumbar spine torsion test. So this test is designed to stress specific levels of the lumbar spine. To do this, the specific level must be rotated and stressed. An example would be testing the integrity of left rotation on L5-S1. Okay. So the patient is placed in the right sideline position with the lumbar spine in the slight extension, that is the lordosis. So here, for the lumbar spine torsion test, the patient position is in sideline position. Okay. Now, lumbar spine will be in slight extension, that is slight lordosis. Now, rotation and the side bending are achieved by the examiner grasping the right arm and pulling it upward and forward at a 45 angle until the movement is felt at the L5 process. This locks all the vertebrae above L4, L5. The examiner then stabilizes the L5 process, spinous process, by holding the left shoulder back with the examiner's elbow while rotating the pelvis and sacrum forward until S1 starts to move. So this position is shown in picture 9.65. So let me show you the picture 9.65. So as you can see here, specific lumbar spine torsion test. See, you can see in picture A, patient is in sideline position. Therapist, one hand is over the shoulder of the opposite hand. One hand is over the lumbar region, L5. You can keep it at L5 region. Okay. The knees, you can see, slightly bent. And now in the picture B, this is the starting position of the test. And now in the picture B, we can see that is the ending position of the test. So rotation is there. Here you can see with this hand, the right hand of the therapist is pulling the pelvis towards therapist And the opposite side, you can see therapist elbow is resting against the patient's shoulder and trying to push it down. Okay, that is the final position. So let us go back to the description of the test. So here we can see lumbar spine torsion test. So examiner stabilizes the L5 spinous process holding the left shoulder. Now this picture we have seen. Minimal movement should occur and the normal capsular tissue stretch should be felt when L5-S1 is stressed by carefully pushing the shoulder back with the elbow and rotating the pelvis forward with the other arm and hand. This test position is common position used to manipulate the spine, so the examiner should take care not to overstretch the rotation during the assessment. So see, excessive rotation also you should not do, because again if you are doing the excessive rotation, that itself can cause many problems. In some cases when doing the test, a click or a pop sound may be heard, and this is the same pop or click that would be heard in case of a manipulation. So when we are doing manipulation also, that time also we can hear that. So what should be normal when you are performing this test? What should be normal? So here they are saying minimal movement should occur and a normal capsular tissue stretch should be felt. So normal capsular tissue stretch, if you are feeling when L5-S1 is stressed, okay, then it will be considered as normal. Okay, but if you are hearing a click sound or a pop sound while doing this test, then see, sometimes the click or pop may also be heard, but that doesn't mean that the patient is having some pathology. You have to always correlate this kind of crepitus or any kind of sound that comes while you are checking for any joint examination. If the sound is coming, but are these sounds are associated with any kind of signs or symptoms or not? That is the main question. If this kind of sounds, whether it is crepitus in the knee joint or it is a pop or a click sound, or in case of lumbar, we are talking about pop and click sound. So if this kind of sounds are associated with the patient's pain, or patient is having any kind of complaints due to that, then only that can be called as pathological sound. Otherwise, normally also, some people may have the noise coming from the joint, but that doesn't mean that the patient is having pathology. Okay. So again, I will show you the picture. So here is the picture showing the specific lumbar spine torsion test. In the picture A, first, this is the starting position. Patient is in sideline position, one hand is grasping the shoulder, other hand is over the lumbar spinous process. In picture B, we can see with the one hand is pulling the pelvis towards the therapist and the opposite hand with the elbow, the therapist is pushing the shoulder back, so giving the downward pressure here in this direction. So normal tissue stretch feeling should be felt at L5-S1. If there is something abnormal, patient is complaining of pain or signs and symptoms and reproduction of the patient's symptoms, then the test will be considered as the positive test. Then the next test is the Farfan torsion test. So this non-specific test traces the facet joint, joint capsule, supraspinous and interspinous ligaments, neural arch, the longitudinal ligaments and the disc. Okay, so see, this is non-specific. Why they are saying non-specific? Because it is not pinpointing any one particular structure. As you can see, they are telling that this particular test, the Farfan torsion test, it is stressing the facet joint, the joint capsule, interspinous ligament, neural arch and so many structure, disc as well as longitudinal ligaments. That is why you can say that this is a non-specific test. Okay, so the examiner stabilizes the ribs and the spine at about T12 level with one hand and places the other hand under the anterior aspect of the ilium. Now the examiner then pulls the ilium backward, that is shown in picture 9.66. Now I will show you the picture later, causing the spine to be rotated on the opposite side, producing the torque on the opposite side. The test is said to be positive if it reproduces all or some of the patient's symptoms. The other side is tested for compression. So let us see 9.66. Here you can see, this is the picture 9.66. Okay, so this is the position. Patient is in prone position, one hand of the therapist over the pelvis, other hand is stabilizing the stabilizing the lumbar region. So here from this hand, the right hand, arrow is shown in the upward direction. So ilium will be pushed in the upper direction in this position. Now if this particular movement is increasing the patient's symptom, then the test will be considered as positive. Next, so I have told you about the Furfan torsion test. Next, coming to the lateral lumbar spine stability test. So here, picture 9.67, that is this picture. So what is lateral lumbar spine stability test? The patient is placed in the supine lying with the lumbar spine in neutral. So again, sideline. So here you can see the patient is in sideline position. Now the examiner places the forearm over the side of the thorax at about the L3 level as an example. So here you can see one hand of the therapist is on the thorax. Now the examiner then applies the downward pressure on the transverse process of the L3. So here you can see black color arrow is showing that the examiner is giving downward pressure on the transverse process, which produces a shear to the side on which the patient is lying for vertebra below L3 and relative lateral shear in the opposite direction to the segments of above L3. Now the production of the patient's symptoms would indicate a positive test. So here you can see it is a very simple test. Patient is in sideline position. You can see the knees are bent. One hand of the therapist is over the pelvis. Other hand is over the thorax region. Here, for example, they have given L3 level, for example. Now the therapist will apply the downward pressure, okay, on the transverse process. And now if this maneuver is reproducing the signs and symptom of the patient, then it will be considered a positive test. Next test is the test for anterior lumbar spine instability. So this is the picture 9.68, anterior lumbar spine instability. So here the patient is placed in the again sideline position with the hip flexed to 70 degree and knees flexed. So here 70 degree of hip flexion and knees are also flexed. Now the examiner palpates the desired spinous process. For example, here you can see the therapist hand is over the lumbar spine and therapist hand is palpating, for example, L4, L5 region. By pushing the patient's knee posteriorly, here you can see with the body of the therapist, you have to push the patient knee posteriorly with the body along with the line of the femur. The examiner can feel the relative movement of the L5 spinous process on L4. So simple test here, patient is in sideline position. Therapist hand is palpating the L4, L5. Now you can also check L3, L4 or L2, L3. Whichever level you are suspecting the instability, you should palpate the same level spinous process and then perform the test. Patient's hip is in 70 degree flexion, knee is in flexion. Then with the body of the therapist is pushing the knees in the posterior direction. And while you are doing this, you should feel the movement, relative movement of the lumbar spinous processes. Okay, now normally there should be little or no movement. Other levels of the spine may be tested in a similar fashion. Our problem with the test is that the examiner should ensure that the posterior ligaments of the spine are relatively loose or relaxed. So normally if you are doing the movement, mild movement or little or either no movement will be felt. Okay, now this can be controlled by altering the amount of hip flexion. So with greater hip flexion, the posterior ligaments tighten up more from the bottom up. So what they are trying to say? So more the hip flexion movement is more, then posterior ligament will tighten up. Okay. Next test, you can see test for the posterior lumbar spine instability 9.69. So this is the picture. The patient sits on the edge of the examining table. The examiner stands in front of the patient. The patient places the pronated arms with the elbows bent on the anterior aspect of the examiner's shoulder. So here you can see the hand is in pronated position and it is placed on the therapist's shoulder. The examiner puts both the hand around the patient so the fingers rest over the lumbar spine. Here you can see both the hands of the therapist is over the lumbar spine. Okay, so now rest over the lumbar spine and with the heels of the hands gently pull the lumbar spine into full lordosis to stress the L5 on S1. The examiner stabilizes the sacrum with the finger of both the hands and asks the patient to push through the forearm while maintaining the lordotic posture. So this produces a posterior shear of L5 on S1. and other levels of the spine may be tested in the similar fashion. So here, patient will be in sitting position, two hands on the therapist shoulder. Therapist hands is over the lumbar spine position, lumbar spine. Now what do you have to do? The examiner stabilizes the sacrum, okay, with both the hands of the both the hands, and ask the patient to push through the forearm while maintaining the lordosis. Okay, so you have to ask the patient to maintain the lordosis and push through the forearm. Next is the segmental instability test. So the patient 9.70, this is the picture. Segmental instability test, picture A and B. Here you can see the toes are on the floor. In picture B, you can see the feet is lifted off the floor. So that is the segmental instability test. So let's see the description. Lies prone, patient is in prone with the body on the examining table and the legs over the edge resting on the floor. The examiner applies pressure to the posterior aspect of the lumbar spine while the patient rests in this position. The patient then lifts the leg off the floor and the examiner again applies the posterior compression to the lumbar spine. If pain is elicited in the resting position only, the test is positive because the muscle action masks the instability. So what they are saying? So resting position, that is when the toes are touching the floor. Okay, so if the pain is elicited in the resting position only, then only the test is considered as positive. So here simple, what the therapist is doing, examiner is applying the pressure to the posterior aspect of the lumbar spine. Okay, so here this is the hand position. Okay, hand, one hand is placed over the other hand and the hand that is beneath is placed over the lumbar spine. So therapist will be in the prone position. Patient will be in the prone position at the edge of the couch. Okay, so therapist will put the downward pressure over the lumbar spine. So one in this picture you can see that is the toes are in resting position, so it is touching the floor. In the second picture you can see toes are lifted, okay, from the floor. So in the first, this position, that is the toes on the floor position, if the patient is having pain or any symptoms, then it is considered as positive. Next is the Fison test. So in this also the patient is in prone. With one hand the examiner gently applies pressure to the posterior aspect of the lumbar spine. With the other hand the examiner passively flexes the patient knee until the heels touch the buttock. Now if the pain is produced in the leg by this hyperextension of the spine, the test is considered positive and indicates an unstable spinal segment. So picture 9.71. Simple test, very simple test, Fison test. Okay, patient is in prone position, one hand is over the lumbar spine, therapist one hand is over the lumbar spine, other hand is over the grasping the ankle, trying to get the heel of the foot to the buttock. So you have to do this movement. Okay, while doing this movement, if the patient is having reproduction of the signs and symptoms, then the Fison test will be considered as positive. So here I have already told you, so patient knees, examiner will passively flexes the patient knees until the heels touch the buttock. And if the pain is produced in the leg by this hyperextension of the spine, so then the test will be considered as positive. So these are the tests for the lumbar spine instability. Most commonly used test, I would say, this segmental instability test, this test. Okay, 9.70, this picture. Okay, when the patient is at the edge of the couch and then toes are touching the floor. In the second part of the test, patient is trying to lift the legs up and therapist is applying the downward pressure. This segmental instability test is most commonly used in the clinical practice. Okay, then this test also we can use test for anterior spine instability. For lateral spine instability, this lateral lumbar spine instability test can be done. Okay, specific torsion test also can be done for the lumbar spine. Then HNI instability test also can be performed. So these are the tests for the lumbar spine. So if you have enjoyed watching this video, then please subscribe to my channel. Press the bell icon to get notified for the next video and share this channel with your friends. Thank you.